Thanks for the invitation, and I'm very thankful to the organizer to give me the opportunity to talk here. Now, before starting my talk, I would like to say that I don't really work on turbulence, so I will try to tell you something about stellar convection, which of course is highly turbulent. So let us see. So before we start with the stellar, of course we'll start with the sun. So the sun, of course, being the nearest star, it provides us with a unique opportunity to study the other stars, or in general the stellar physics. And sun has also played an important role in understanding of physics, starting from general relativity, nuclear physics, neutrino physics, and so on. So a major source of uncertainty in the current solar models is the treatment of convection. And the solar convection zone is highly turbulent, and because of that, the proper treatment is not possible. And this convection also plays an important role in maintaining the differential rotation profile, as well as the meridional flow and solar dynamo. Yesterday, we heard an interesting talk about the solar dynamo, so I will tell you a little bit about the other things also. So this is a cartoon of the sun. So in the center, temperature is about 15 million degrees, and that is where the energy is generated by the nuclear fusion. And this energy comes out through radiation up to about 70% of the solar radius. After that, the opacity becomes pretty high, and radiation cannot transmit the required amount of flux. So convection takes over, and the outer about 30% of the region in the solar radius, the energy is transmitted by convection. So that is what, and this convection actually manifests on the surface in the form of granulation. I will show you the picture about that. Now the temperature at the surface is about 6,000 degrees Kelvin, and it decreases further as you go out to about 4,000 degrees. And after that, something strange happens, and the temperature actually starts increasing and reaches again another few million degrees Kelvin in the corona, which is the outside thing, what you see. Now this is again another important problem which we don't understand fully as to why the temperature suddenly starts increasing. That is the problem of coronal heating, but I will not be talking about that. So let us, so this is a picture of the solar surface. So you can see there are, it is not uniform, but there are bright and dark spots. So these are the so-called granules. So the granules are basically the convective cells which transmit the heat. So the hot fluid comes from below and it mixes with the surrounding at the surface, and then the cold fluid goes down. So the hot fluid appears brighter and the cold one, which is going down, appears darker. And the typical scale of these granules is about 1,000 to 2,000 kilometer. Lifetime is some 5 to 10 minutes. And velocity of 1 to 2 kilometers per second. And you can actually study this in using a Doppler shift, and you can actually find that the things are actually coming up and going down, and actually you can even have movies also, though I don't have those things. So I will show you a little better picture of the granules afterwards. So this is the power spectrum of the vertical velocity. So you can see that there is a peak around the one between something like 1 to 2 megameters. That is the preferred scale of convection. Now apart from that, there is also, this is not the only scale. There are other scales of convection also which are preferred. So this is another thing which is known as the super granules. This was first discovered by Hart in 1954. So there's so basically this is much larger scale of about 30,000 kilometers and time scale of about 1 day, and the velocity is somewhat smaller of 500 meters per second. Preferably, most of it is horizontal velocity. So what you can do is that you can average over a shorter scale so that granules will get averaged. And then if you plot the thing, then you will see that predominantly the velocity is near the limb, because this is horizontal velocity. So because since we can measure only the line of sight velocity, so in the center it will be the radial part, that you will not see anything. So you see most of the signature only near the limb, where it will be the horizontal velocity will be pointing towards us. So this is predominantly in the horizontal velocity. Of course, the vertical velocity has also been measured. It is of the order of 100-200 meters per second. So these are also similar to grain. They are much larger size. So this is again the power spectrum of horizontal velocity. So you can see that there is another peak around 30,000 kilometers. So that is what is the supergranulation. Now, of course, it is still not understood why we have these two distinct scales. And of course, there are people who have suggested even more number of scales. In fact, there is a suggestion that there is also some intermediate scale between granulation and supergranulation known as mesogranulation, though that has not been properly confirmed. Similarly, there are also claims of giant cells which are comparable to the solar radius, but these are also not established. But the two scales which are established are granulation and supergranulation, and that also we don't understand theoretically why these two scales happen. As far as the granulation is concerned, that is understood more or less in the sense that if you do numerical simulation, you also find that scale. And even if you do a linear stability analysis, you will find that the most unstable mode corresponds to somewhere near that length scale. So that is understood, but the supergranulation is not understood. And there are some conjecture that supergranulation could be due to helium ionization layer, which is below the solar surface at a depth of about 10 to 15,000 kilometers. So that could be driving this cell. But again, that is also not confirmed. So now let us take about the solar convection zone. So the outer 30% of the solar radius energy is transmitted by convection. And so far, there is no theory to calculate the convective flux in this highly turbulent compressible fluid. And this is a major source of uncertainty, as I told you earlier. So in the upper layers of the solar convection zone, the radiative transfer is also important, because convection also becomes inefficient because the density is very low. The density near the top of the convection zone is about 3 into 10 to the minus 7 grams per cc. So that is too low to transmit the flux by convection, and that is where the temperature gradient goes up and some part of the energy is transmitted by radiation once again. So the stellar model, of course, in order to construct stellar models, we need to calculate the convective flux. Since there is no theory, there are some prescriptions which are given, which is known as the mixing length theory. Although it is called a theory, but there is really no theory there. It is just some prescription to calculate the convective flux. So it is basically written, rho is the density, this is the typical velocity, the specific heat, the length scale, and this is the temperature gradient and minus the adiabatic gradient. So that is basically what it is. This you can easily derive from the dimensional ground. And that typically there will be this mixing length has a parameter also in that. So that will take care of, and that is basically adjusted to get the proper solar model. So of course, looking at this, we do not expect it to work properly, but it has been remarkably successful. And in fact, all stellar models are constructed using this or some variation of that. So in most of the cases, one of the important reason why this actually works is that in most of the convection zone, this quantity is very small. So it doesn't matter. The temperature gradient will be almost adiabatic. So you can take it equal to adiabatic and construct the model. That also will be good enough. But we generally use this prescription. So that is good enough. And the only adjustable parameter which is there is used to actually get the correct entropy at the base of the convection zone. So the only rigorous method to compute convective flux is the direct numerical simulation, which we have heard enough. So I will not tell you more about it, except that it doesn't really work. So the main problem is that if you measure the Reynolds number, which has been described n number of times here, the solar convection zone, the value is about 10 to the 15. So that is fairly large. And that is the main reason why the direct numerical simulation does not work effectively. And the convective eddies have a wide range of length and time scales, and the numerical simulations have to resolve all these scales. So further, the solar convection zone also has a strong stratification with the density varying by 6 orders of magnitude from the base to the surface. So because of which you have to use compressibility. Unfortunately, most of the theories of convection or for incompressible or inelastic or some other approximation. So those things are not applicable directly to the sun. So if you look at the theory of turbulence, you can see that the ratio of the largest to the smallest length scale will be given by the Reynolds number to the 3/4. So in three dimension, you will need Reynolds number to the 9/4 number of grid points. And further, of course, if you have to evolve this, the time step will also be limited by the current condition, and that will give you a similar number of time steps. So the total number of effort required will be of the order of Reynolds number to the power 3, which will be about 10 to the 45. So that many operations or some kind of thing will be required. And of course, if you want to cover the dynamic, this is only to cover the dynamical time scale, but if you are interested in thermal time scale, we'll need another few orders of magnitude, and that will make it to be 10 to the power 50. So that is well beyond the scope of current computers. So even if you take all the existing computers in the world, you will not be able to do this calculation. And even if you assume that the Moore's law is applicable for the rest of the 21st century, we'll still have computers capable of about 10 to the 35 flops at best, and that will also not be sufficient to do the computation. So this is clearly beyond the scope of computation in the near future. So in actual practice, of course, the maximum thing that we have achieved is 4096 cube mesh points. So that is basically good enough for about Reynolds number of 10 to the 6 or so. So that is very far from the solar value. So another thing which you can do is the large eddy simulation. We had just a good lecture on that to take care of the unresolved eddies. But of course, that also will have some limitation because, you know, you have huge number of scales which are unresolved. So that is also not good enough for that. So most of the calculations have been done by using an ad hoc approach by putting some artificial viscosity. So I will just tell you something about the numerical simulations. Of course, none of this has been done by me. So the numerical simulations are typically have a rectangular size of something like 6,000 by 6,000 by 4,000 kilometers. So that is, of course, much smaller than the size of the sun. The solar radius is 700,000 kilometers. So this is not even 1% of that. So the observations show that the dominant size of the convective cells is 2,000 kilometers, which we know. And this is actually reproduced by these simulations. So this actually shows the picture of both. This is the actual picture of solar granulation taken from the Swedish solar telescope at La Palma by these people. And this is a numerical simulation by these people. So you can see that at least the pattern looks similar, so which basically gives some confidence that the numerical simulations are able to at least explain the solar granulation, which is the dominant scale of convection. Yeah, because I told you, no, it's only 4,000 kilometers, so it is only outer part. So that is true. So this is now, of course, if you have the simulations, we can also calculate the temperature profile. Now in the simulation, of course, when we construct solar model, we assume that it is spherically symmetric and we have one temperature gradient. But in the simulation, of course, since it is convective cells are there, the temperature profile will be different at every point. So this actually shows the lots of temperature profiles at different points on the surface. I mean, you go down. So that is there, and of course, this is the extreme values, and there is some mean value somewhere in between. So that is there. Now, the question is, how does that compare with the temperature profile that we use in the standard solar model? So this is the thing which I tried to superpose the two. So this red curve is the what we use in the solar model. So of course, you can see that there is some offset, and that offset is because the definition of the solar surface used in the solar model and in the numerical simulation is not the same. So if we correct for that offset, then you can see that the temperature profile in the solar model that we assume more or less matches with that. And that also is one of the reasons for the success of the mixing lab. So now this, apart from that, this theory, this model was also used to calculate the line profiles In the solar spectrum, there are many absorption lines which are formed by the absorption from elements which are present in the solar atmosphere. So these are the Fraunhofer lines, and they are used for various purposes, or not only to study the atmospheric model, but also to measure the solar abundances and so on. So it is important that you can model these profiles very well. So the same numerical simulations which were used, which I showed you, were used by these people to construct the line profile, which also requires radiative transfer calculation. So this is an oxygen line. So this is the observed and the calculated thing. You can see that there is a good match. This line is actually a blend between an oxygen line and a nickel line. So this oxygen contribution is here, nickel contribution is here, and the total thing goes to this. So both the things match. So that is also another success of this simulations. Now, apart from that, what happens is that because of the correlation between the temperature and the velocity, because what happens is that the hotter fluid is coming from below, so that has a higher temperature, and because of which it emits more radiation, while the colder fluid which goes down is colder, so because of that it emits less heat. So because of that, then if you look at the net profile, then you will find that it effectively, on an average, it tends to get a blue shifted because it is preferably coming towards us. So if you take the line, so because of that, the lines are not symmetric, and if you take the line bisector, that is an important diagnostic of the convection. So near the center of the solar disk, the net blue shift is about 500 meters per second because of convection, and this largely cancels the gravitational redshift of about 633 meters per second. So this, but the convective blue shift varies with the position on the solar disk, because when you are seeing at the center of the disk, it is coming towards us, but as you go towards the limb, it will become horizontal velocity will be coming towards us. So because of the projection effect, that blue shift will decrease. So this was something which was actually observed long back, and this was the main reason why the gravitational redshift could not be confirmed in the solar spectral line, because if you know, most of the initial tests of general relativity came from solar observations, like the shift of, perihelion shift of Mercury, as well as the deflection of light. But this could not be done because although in principle the accuracy was sufficient to observe the redshift of 633 meters per second, because of the convective blue shift, but there were no models for convection at that time, and it was not possible to separate out the two effects. And in fact, people did not know why the blue shift varies across the solar disk. And in fact, there were many models were put forward to explain this, and some of the crazy models even included non-zero photon mass and so on. So this appeared in Nature in 1979. So this is the paper. You can try to read it, what it shows. But so that was put forward to explain something which, of course, did not exist. So now, of course, we know that this is because of convection, and people have done extensive tests. So this is from a more recent paper of Esplund and his colleague in 2000. So this is a line bisector. So if there is no turbulence, then the line will be symmetric. So the bisector will be straightforward like this, 1D. And so this shape of the bisector gives us the characteristic of the convection. And by comparing what you get from the numerical simulation to the actual observation, you can actually test whether the simulations are good or not. So these are the tests for some of the lines. So this is what, so this you can see that it agrees very well. So this can actually be used to study convection not only in the sun, but even in other stars also, because you can observe the spectral line in other stars, although you cannot resolve the stellar surface, so you will not be able to see the granulation pattern directly, but you can study the asymmetry in the spectral line, and from that you can conclude something about the convection in other stars. So these Dravins, in a series of papers, including this one, they have modeled the bisector in many stars and compared them with the convective simulations for those stars. And some of these results are shown here. So these are different stars. So you can see that the shape of the bisector varies quite significantly between different stars. So that depends on the length scale and the velocity and other things about the stars. So, but all of them could be reproduced by the numerical simulation for the corresponding stars. So basically you take the simulation or the similar temperature, etc., what you expect for that star, and then you do compare the line bisector. Of course, you can see that this actually is not a bisector, because the bisector is actually very, the asymmetry is very small, so the bisector is always scaled up by a factor of 10 or something like that. So obviously this will not be the actual bisector. Actual bisector will be close to the center, so it is magnified by that. So, but that can still be explained. So that was a success of the numerical simulations. So now the spectral line profiles can also be used to calculate the abundances of elements in the sun, because if the element is more abundant, then the absorption will be more and the line will be deeper and so on. So before the 3D simulations became possible, the abundances were calculated by the 1D semi-empirical models of atmosphere, which had some parameters to characterize turbulence and so on. And these parameters were adjusted to reproduce the lines which are all formed in the solar atmosphere. So when the 1D abundances were used to construct the solar model, the structure matched the sound speed and density profile as inferred from heliosismology. So that was one of the success of the solar models and also of the heliosismology. But now when the abundances were revised using the 3D simulations for the first time by Esplund and his colleague in 2004, then these abundances were all revised downwards, and oxygen abundance was reduced by about 45%. Oxygen is the third most abundant element after hydrogen and helium. And abundance of other heavy elements was also reduced. This reduces the ratio Z by X, which is the abundance of heavy elements to hydrogen, from a value of 0.023 to 0.0165. And once you reduce the heavy elements, because they predominantly provide the opacity in the solar convection zone, because the electronic transition, because hydrogen and helium get ionized in the upper layers, so after that they will not contribute much to the opacity. So all the opacity is mostly contributed by the heavy elements, and once you reduce their abundance, the opacity will be reduced, and because of that the solar models will no longer be consistent with heliosismology. And after that, a lot of efforts have been made to, of course, that will come to later. So this is the result what we get. So this is the solar model using the old abundance. This is the difference in the sound speed square and the density between the sun and the solar model as inferred from seismology. So I will not tell you how it is inferred, but let us assume that somehow you can do that. So you can see that when you use the old abundance, you get a much better model. And you use the new abundance, you get a model which is off by at least a factor of few. So both the sound speed and density. So there is clearly a problem there. So because of this reduction, basically the problem comes because the opacity is reduced. And one can estimate how much the opacity will need to be increased to get the models back in agreement. And that is about something between 10 to 25%. So that much increase in opacity is not quite acceptable to, of course, none of these opacities are actually measured in lab, because you cannot measure it at that temperature and density. So all these are theoretically calculated using the known atomic physics, and people who do the calculation do not think that that level of uncertainty is there in those calculations. And in fact, soon after this results came, there was an independent opacity calculation by the opacity project, which was compared with the old opacity which was used by OPAL opacities, and the difference is only 2%, so it is much less than what is required. So of course that doesn't help. And after that, there were lots of efforts were made to modify the solar models to solve the problem, but none of them was successful. So after that, people started looking at the abundances more carefully, and a lot of work has gone into that. And these are various people who have tried abundances using different techniques. So this is actually logarithmic abundance, so with the ratio, so the abundance of hydrogen is 12 on this scale, so this, the high oxygen abundance is about 10 to the minus 3 of the hydrogen abundance by number. So this people got a value of 8.86 as compared to the old value of 8.83, so which is consistent with that. These people got slightly lower value. Then Esplund themselves also, they themselves also revised their calculation and revised it slightly upwards, but not enough to get the full agreement. Then these people also gave a table of abundance which gives Z by X of 0.19 Then this people have given 209 and so on. After that, there was some attempt at the Sandhya Z facility to measure the opacity at temperature of 2 into 2 million degrees, and they did find that the opacities are somewhat higher than the opal values, but of course it is very difficult to interpret these measurements. So now, of course, since we have different measures of abundance, we can calculate, we can do the same exercise for all solar models constructed using different abundances. So these are the revised thing, earlier thing, and so on, the next one. And you can see that this latest revision by this, this is also based on 3D numerical computation, numerical simulations. So that actually matches with the old thing. So you can see that, so basically the problem is not so much with the solar model, but the problem is with the abundance determination, which of course is based on the numerical simulation. So there is still some issue with the numerical simulations. And of course, it's not just the numerical simulations, the radiative transfer also goes into this. And apart from that, most of these lines are not in thermodynamic equilibrium. So the corrections for that is also has to be applied. So all those things may be uncertain. So because of that, there may be some variation. So now let us go to that. So apart from that, there is another thing also, of course, above the surface of the solar convection zone, you can see the atmosphere, you can see the velocity, and you can see that the convective eddies penetrate into the stable layers, and which is what you would expect. They penetrate to a distance comparable to the pressure scalite. But there was no idea about what happens below the base of the convection zone. And the numerical simulations all showed that there should be a large overshoot below the solar convection zone. So for example, these people here, but of course this is many other people also have done that. But then of course we can do this also, we can check this with seismology. And when heliosismic results were obtained, and there is also the problem of lithium and beryllium abundance at the solar surface. So the lithium and beryllium can be destroyed by nuclear reactions at a fairly low temperature. Lithium can be destroyed at a temperature of about 2.5 million degrees and beryllium at slightly higher temperature. While the temperature at the base of the convection zone is about 2.2 million degrees, so that is not sufficient to destroy lithium. But the solar lithium abundance is about two orders of magnitude lower than the meteoritic abundance, so which means that the lithium has been destroyed there. Now that can happen if there is some mixing below the base of the solar convection zone, and that puts the limit on the mixing because the beryllium abundance is not depleted. So both of them together put some strong limit on the overshoot that is possible. And there are other tests also using heliosismic results, and all those tests showed that the overshoot extent is extremely small, less than about 0.05 of the pressure scalite. So it is significantly less than what the simulation sets found. But then there are improved simulations have been put using increasing Reynolds number and so on, and they find that the extent of overshoot does decrease, but of course they have not reached anywhere near the solar value, so they cannot predict what will happen for the solar case. So the main problem is, as with all simulations, is that they cannot resolve all relevant scales of turbulence, so the predictions have to be taken cautiously. Now apart from that, there is another issue, that is the solar differential rotation. Now, so observations of the sunspot and other features on the solar surface show that the sun is rotating. In fact, it was Galileo who first found that the sun is rotating when he observed the sunspot through the telescope in 1609. He found that the sunspots are actually moving every day from one position to another, and that he concluded that the sun is rotating. Of course, at that time, people were not convinced, because some people thought that sunspots are not actually on the sun, but they are some planets which are coming between us and the sun. But Galileo, with a painstaking effort using projection effect and other things, showed that these sunspots are actually on the sun, and there is nothing, no planets coming there. So, but then soon after that, it was also found that the rotation velocity is not constant, this differential rotation. So, which basically means that the equator is rotating faster than the pole. At the equator, the rotation rate, the rotation period is about 25 days, while at the poles it goes to about 30 days. So there is a differential rotation. Now, of course, nobody knows, or nobody knew until recently, that what happens below the convection, below the surface. And there were a lot of numerical simulations were done, particularly by these people and others, and they showed that the rotation rate should be constant on cylinders. So it should be, a function only of the distance from the solar rotation axis and not of the radius. So that will, of course, that can explain the differential rotation, because the distance of the equator will be more than that at the pole. But of course, at that time, nobody could challenge that. So people thought that that is what is the solar rotation inside. But when the heliosismic data became available, it was possible to infer the solar rotation rate in the interior, and the result was totally different from what was predicted. So this again is another failure of numerical simulations. And of course, since then, there are a lot of effort has been put forward to tune the numerical simulations to get results which are comparable to observed rotation rate, but they are not totally successful, though now they can produce results which are closer to the observations. So this is the inferred rotation rate from heliosismology as a function of radius. So this is as a function of the solar radius. So this is the surface, interior will be somewhere, center will be down there. So at the surface, and this is at a different latitude. So this top one is the equator, then 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, up to 80 degrees latitude. So you can see that at the surface, the rotation rate is decreasing as you go from equator to pole. This is in the units of nanohertz. And then as you go inside it, initially there is some increase in the rotation rate as you go deeper inside. Now this was something which people expected, because people know that young stars are rotating faster than the old stars, and that, so which basically means that the angular momentum is lost, and that is happens because of the stellar wind and other things. So it was expected, since all this loss of angular momentum happens from the surface, it was thought that the interior may be rotating faster than the surface. So this was not surprising, but after that it levels off, and somewhere here, which is the base of the convection zone, is about 0.7. So somewhere here there is a very sharp transition from differential rotation to almost a solid body rotation in the interior. So these dotted lines are just the error bars on that. The solid lines are the actual estimate. So this is a something which was not predicted by anybody, and this transition region is known as a tachocline. So this, of course, has been very useful for the dynamo people, because this gives the shear which is used to generate the solar dynamo. At least that is what they think. And even now we don't know why this layer happens. So the origin of tachocline is not understood, and a lot of efforts have gone into that. And another interesting thing is that if the rotation rate in the core is actually not much larger than the, actually not larger than the surface rotation rate. So that is also another thing, because if the core were rotating faster than the surface by a significant amount, then the sun will have significant quadrupole moment, and that can give rise to the precession of the perihelion of Mercury, and it can disturb the agreement with relativity. And some people in fact had suggested that. But now after the measurement of this, we know that that is not the case. So that I already told you. So simulation with magnetic field also have been done to explain the formation of tachocline, but they do not fully explain the formation of tachocline. So that is something to do with angular momentum transport in the solar interior, but that is not understood. So now apart from that, there is also meridional flow, which Arnab yesterday talked about. So this meridional flow is the north-south component of velocity, which has also been observed at the solar surface, but that is much smaller than the rotation velocity, because rotation velocity, if you take the speed that was given, that comes out to about 2 kilometers per second at the surface. At the equator, of course, it will go down near the pole. So, but as compared to that, the meridional flow is only of the order of 10 to 20 meters per second. And in both the hemisphere, it is from equator towards the pole, with the maximum value happens somewhere around 45 degrees latitude in both the hemispheres. So this, of course, the origin of meridian flow can be understood as the consequence interaction between the convection and the differential rotation, and people had in fact predicted that there should be a meridional flow. So that was actually, the surface measurements were done by using the Doppler shift and also by measuring the shift of the sunspot and other magnetic features. So now the question is, what happens in the interior? Now if the at the surface the meridional flow goes from equator to the pole, now somewhere of course the material has to come back towards the equator, otherwise everything will accumulate at the pole, which is obviously not possible. So there has to be a return flow, but the question is that what depth the return flow happens is not known, and that is very important for the dynamo theories. Most of the dynamo theories assume that the return flow happens near the base of the convection zone. So if that is not the case, then the dynamo, at least the flux transport dynamo models, will not be valid. So now, of course, can we infer the meridional flow using the heliosismology? So heliosismology is basically based on the study of solar interior using the observed frequencies of solar oscillations. So these frequencies have been measured very accurately. These are the frequencies of the global modes of oscillation, which means the entire sun is oscillating at this thing, and there are almost 1 million independent modes which have been observed. So they give you all information about the structure and rotation and everything. But unfortunately, all these global oscillation modes, because of the symmetry, are to the first order not sensitive to the contribution to the of the meridional flow. So which means that you have to take a second order effect using the quasi-degenerate perturbation theory. So you can do that, but of course then the result is much smaller. So the effect is much smaller in that case, and it is difficult to detect that using the observed frequencies. So there are other, apart from that, this quasi-degenerate perturbation theory will also give some mode coupling between different modes, and that coupling can in principle be seen. But so people have made that effort also, but that is also not very successful, so some effort has been done in that direction. So in order to do that, you have to go to some different thing, which is known as the local heliosismic techniques. So local heliosismic techniques basically means that they are not the global modes, but there are two competing techniques. One is the ring diagram analysis, and another is the time distance analysis. So the ring diagram analysis is basically similar to the global mode analysis, except that you don't look for the mode over the entire solar surface, but you look at a small part of the solar surface and study the oscillations in that. So the reason for doing that is that when you go to a small length scale, which means very large values of the degree L, in that case, those mode lifetime is smaller than the sound travel time around the solar surface. So because of that, these modes can be assumed to be local, because they don't have enough lifetime to give a global mode, because so those modes can be used. On the other possibility is to use the time distance heliosismology, which is similar to the terrestrial heliosismology, because where you don't worry about the frequency, but you take the travel time from one point to another on the solar surface. Now if you take a travel time from, let us say, point A to point B, and then you measure another travel time from B to A, if there is no velocity, no motion, then both the travel time should be same. But if there is a flow, then there will be a difference. So if you take the difference between the two travel time, that will be sensitive to the flows, and that can be used to study the flows. So that is what is done. That can be done for both. Of course, rotation, it is not needed, because the global mode gives you a much more accurate picture as compared to this. So that, although people have tried this to confirm, test the method, but beyond that, that is not the reason required. But for meridional flow, we can try to do that. So ring diagram studies has been used to study, but the ring diagram study, since it uses high L modes, it cannot go deeper inside the sun. So you can get information only about a little bit below the solar surface. Yeah, so this is what we get from the ring diagram analysis. So this is at a different depth, starting from somewhere near just below the solar surface to slightly below the solar surface. So these are measured at different times. So these times are anyway given there. So you can see that the main pattern is, of course, in both hemisphere, it goes, and there is a maximum somewhere near 40 to 50 degrees. And after that, it may come down. In some cases, it doesn't appear to come down, but these are all because of projection effects in this, so we cannot trust these measurements. So now, of course, apart from that, we can also use time distance analysis, and that I already explained. So now, let us see. So these are the results obtained by the meridional flow from time distancing by these people in 2013, so you're not very long back. So they found that, so if you take, this is a positive thing, so this is, of course, let us say this is going towards the pole, but then they find a return flow somewhere in between the convection zone. This is the base of the convection zone, 0.7. So which means that they have a multiple cell. So this is a cross-section, so you can see that the velocity, of course, initially it turns, it crosses over at somewhere around 0.9, and then it crosses back at 0.8. So there is a, of course, this is not double cell, but it is one and half cell in the convection zone, because one cell is complete, other is not complete, because it has to be completed by the reverse flow. And of course, it is not possible to go below the depth of about 0.7 using time distancing also, because the point, because the choice of point A and B have to be on the solar surface, and that limits how far down you can go. So that was the thing. So this is, of course, if this is true, then there will be problem with the solar dynamo models, because the flux transport dynamo will not apply in this case, because the return flow is somewhere inside this. Because the flux dynamo models assume that the meridional flow carries over the magnetic field just like a conveyor belt. So if it carries over and it goes inside the convection zone, then the flux will immediately rise because of magnetic buoyancy, and the dynamo effect will not happen there. So that is not possible, so you have to go below the base of the convection zone, then only you can have dynamo effect. Then only the dynamo can operate. So after this results were put forward, obviously many other people also tried this, and we also tried to use this, so we improved a little bit on their thing. They had actually calculated only the theta component of the velocity, which is the dominant thing. The radial component is much smaller, less than 1 meter per second. So we, instead of that, we used the stream function to calculate both radial and theta, r and theta component of the meridional flow, and we used the inversion using some inversion technique, and to get more realistic error estimate, we also changed the smoothing parameters and so on. And this is what we find. So this is published 2 years after that. So here, of course, the color map is not on the same thing, but so this is going towards the pole, and now you find the return flow near the base of the convection zone. So if this is true, then the flux transport dynamo models may still be possible. And apart from that, these flux transport dynamo models also, the time taken from the meridional flow to travel from something here to pole to equator also, according to that, should give you the time of the solar cycle, which is about 11 years. So that also constrains the velocities. So of course, the velocities which we find are probably slightly higher, so their time will be slightly less than 11 years, but of course, there are significant uncertainties in that. So that may still match the flux requirement of the flux transport dynamo. Now this is the cuts again. So you can see that these are the cuts with radius at different latitudes. So you can see that this thing at near at the low latitude, it tends to go towards the, tends to cross, but of course this is comparable to the error bar, so you don't know whether it has crossed or not. But after that, actual crossing seems to happen somewhere here. So that is what we find, and the same thing is, of course, at different latitudes are there. So sorry, this is the radial component. So the radial component is much less. This is the horizontal component, which is about 15, 20 meters per second. This is about 1 meter per second. So the radial component starts from zero near the surface, which has to be there, because otherwise it will come out of the surface. And then again, it tends to become zero somewhere near the base of the convection zone. Well, in our inversion, we had imposed the boundary condition of V, that U r equal to zero at the surface, but we did not impose any condition here. But even then, they are tending to zero at that point. Okay, so now, of course, the convection is also modified by the presence of magnetic field. Numerical simulations have been done, including the magnetic field also. And these studies have been used to study the dynamics of magnetic field in the solar convection zone, as well as the formation of tachocline, structure of sunspots, and the possible dynamo actions. So a number of results have been obtained, but I don't think there is any striking success of these models in the sense that they have not really been able to explain any of the observed features unambiguously. And one important feature they find is that there are many plumes which penetrate much deeper than the normal convective cells. So that is one of the things which they have found, but of course, whether that actually happens in the sun or not, we don't know. Yeah, so this is the picture of the sun taken in ultraviolet wavelength. So you can see, so this actually traces the magnetic field lines, because there is a plasma which moves along the magnetic field line and it radiates, so you can actually trace the magnetic field there. So you can see that the geometry is pretty complicated. It is not like your bar magnet. There are some lines going here, some in between, and so on. So this is a complicated geometry of magnetic field. And this is, of course, this must be two sunspots somewhere there. And of course, you can see the solar surface, something like this. So that can give you the scale of this. Things. So none of these things can be explained. Of course, this is above the solar surface, where the magnetic field actually plays an important role, because the magnetic pressure there will become comparable or larger than the gas pressure. So it is a magnetic field which dominates, while below the surface, the magnetic pressure is very small, smaller than the gas pressure. And as you go deeper down, it is much smaller. For example, near the base of the convection zone, it will definitely be smaller than 10 to the minus 4 or so. Of course, we don't know what is the magnetic field there, but you can put the upper limit of that. Latitudes, I will not know, but this will be typical sunspot latitudes of 20 degrees or something like that, because this must be true sunspots. So since sunspots occur not beyond 30 degrees, so this must be around that latitude. So yeah, I have already said this. So another problem with the atmosphere is that these regions are not in equilibrium, and the structure is also not spherically symmetric. As you can see, even the corona is not spherically symmetric. So all these factors make it even more difficult to simulate this layer. So there also there is turbulence, so there is no convection there. The energy is mostly radiated out, and it is basically an optically thin situation, so it just goes out. And of course, we still, this is also play an important role in heating of the corona. Now, coronal heating is still not fully understood. Obviously, magnetic field are playing the role because they are related to the magnetic regions. But the main problem is not how the energy is transmitted outwards. The main problem is how the energy has to be deposited at the right place, at the right amount to heat the thing to the whatever extent has been observed. And that has not been fully understood. So and this also plays an important role in solar flares and coronal mass ejections. Now, these are violent events which are happening in the solar atmosphere, and they affect the Earth also, and they affect the basically so-called space weather, which is very crucial for the Earth's magnetosphere also, and particularly for the operation of the satellite. So these are some things which are not understood. So I think I will just, so this is the summary of what I have to say. So basically, the numerical treatment of stellar convection is beyond the scope of computers in near future. And the numerical simulations have been very successful in reproducing solar granulation and absorption line profiles in stellar spectrum. However, using the profiles to calculate solar abundance has considerable uncertainties, and simulations have completely failed to identify multiple scales of solar convection and also to simulate anything in the deeper layer. In fact, I think Shravan will probably tell you about the test of solar convection using heliosismology. So that also has not been there. Also, the simulations have failed. And there is only a limited success in simulating solar differential rotation or meridional flow or solar dynamo. So that is the current status. And thank you for the attention.
Thank you very much. So, thank you for finishing the talk before the time. So, questions?
Yeah.
I understand your somewhat of a pessimistic remark on the meridional flow.
Yeah.
But aren't you being too pessimistic about differential rotation somehow?
Well, I have seen many of these simulations. They still tend to go towards the constant in cylinder thing. If you look at the profile, they tend towards that rather than towards the actual observed thing. So it is not fully clear. But and of course, the tachocline, they are not able to produce anyway.
And your own calculations rule out the multi-cell structure for the meridional flow. Do I understand?
Well, I will not say they rule out. Since both the things people have calculated for the same sun, so obviously one of them will be correct and the other will not be correct. So I mean, but only thing is, if you believe in our results, then yes, that is true. But otherwise, of course, I cannot say that it definitely rules out. So
what kind of boundary conditions did you have on the surface for the
surface? We only put the UR equal to zero, the radial component equal to zero.
Or the other?
No, at other end, we don't put any condition. And of course, the only problem is that we don't have the complete 0 to pi by 2 thing, because you can't go near the poles, so somewhere some arbitrary thing is there. But there is no boundary condition there. We have only some region which is useful. So,
okay, other questions?
Sir, what is the role of equation of state in the calculations?
Yeah, equation of state, of course, plays an important role as far as the solar models are concerned, the stratification of the solar model is concerned. But as far as the rotation or meridional flow, etc., I am not sure whether they will have, because these are well understood at that point. In fact, even throughout the solar interior, there is not much uncertainty in the equation of state. Though, of course, the calculations have improved since heliosismology came. For example, before the seismic data was available, it's not that people did not know. For example, the Coulomb correction was not applied in the equation of state because the density in the surface region is about 10 to the minus 4 or so. So people did not think that Coulomb correction would be important. But when the heliosismic results were obtained, there was a significant deviation. And then it was soon realized that if you apply Coulomb correction, that will go away and so on. So there have been improvements after the seismology has come, but I would not say that there is much uncertainty there currently. So if you are using the best equation of state which is currently available, then there should not be any problem. But of course, all these simulations may not be using that. That is possible.
Yeah, next question, please.
So how thick is the oversuit? I mean, how reliably you know about the oversuit?
Well, we don't know the overshoot region properly, but it will of the order of something like 5% of the pressure scale height. The pressure scale height at that point is about 50,000 kilometers, so 1/20th of that. That is the extent. So that will be a few thousand kilometers. So that is a very small fraction of solar radius. So it will be about 1 or 2% of solar radius, and that is consistent with the lithium and beryllium depletion also. They also require about 2-3%, not more than that. So,
yeah.
So I know that the major velocity profiles plotted from the helioseismology.
Yes. Yeah, the angular momentum also we have studied, and it also shows the consistent variation. There is not, if you average over the entire thing, of course, there is no change in angular momentum. But of course, if you take a different layer, there is a change in angular momentum with time. But there is an anti-angular momentum exchange between different layers. That we can find out. In fact, we have published papers also on that.
Any other question? So, I got a very important message from your talk with the initial slides about the small scale simulation. You said DNS and LES is not useful for the solar convection, and we have
useful
to wait till the next century. We have to wait according to Moore's law. Thank you very much.
Hopefully
for
somebody will come with a clever idea to bypass that.
Yeah. Okay, let's thanks again to the speaker. Thank you. And what is that?